All right, welcome back to our channel, guys. I'm Rod. I'm here with my dad,
Rod Senior,
and we are Bridging the Gap. Yes, sir. So welcome back. Thank you so much for being here. If you do enjoy our reaction videos, please make sure you give this video a big thumbs up. Also, drop a comment. Let us know what album we should listen to next. And turn on your post notifications to make sure that you are notified every single time we drop a brand new video. With no further ado, we are listening to Pimp a Butterfly today, Pop. And I've given my dad some background information and kind of filled him in a little bit as far as what we're going to be undertaking today. Today is probably one of the most complex albums that we've listened to as far as just like storyline and like concept and stuff like that. I kind of broke it down to my dad that there's different kind of acts throughout the album, and there's a whole narrative throughout the album, and there's a poem that helps push the album and push the narrative through. So I just kind of let him know that stuff just so he knows kind of how to listen to this album that we're going to listen to, and just gave him that preface. But again, we're going, he's never heard this before, and we're going to get his reaction. So from what I've told you, Dad, what do you know about Kendrick Lamar? I mean, we've listened to his Good Kid, Mad City album. What do you think about what we're about to listen to on to Pimp a Butterfly?
Well, I honestly don't know what to think about it, but generally when I'm listening to any artist that you present to me, you know, my key focus is on the creativity. Mm-hmm. And you know, I like music. I like the musical content of it, mm-hmm. the production, so to speak. And then I look for individual traits that separate one rapper from the next. Mm-hmm. And so Kendrick, everybody seems to. I did read some of the comments where everybody was talking about to pimp a butterfly, mm-hmm. and the title was intriguing to me because of the fact that. I don't know how you pimp a butterfly. So I really want to know, I hope this album kind of explains to me, mm-hmm. in some way, form or fashion.
Yeah.
How you pimp a butterfly.
Yeah.
But I'm interested in, because it seems like everybody loves this album, mm-hmm. because they mentioned it so much. So I hope that it's, I got high hopes for it. Mm-hmm. And, y'all don't be mad at me if I don't like it. I'm gonna tell you.
Yeah. It's received so much critical acclaim, probably more than any album that I can think of in the recent past. And I mean, it's got like a Pulitzer Prize. It won a bunch of Grammys.
Wow.
I mean, it's
a Pulitzer.
Yeah, and it's just been across the board, critics and rap enthusiasts.
So he got everything but a Nobel Peace Prize.
Pretty much.
No, just, yeah. Okay. So I hope it's good, man. I like really good music. So I hope the music is good. If I can remember, the first one we listened to was more like he had a jazzy feel to mm-hmm. a lot of his music. So you know, I'm looking forward to see what else he did as far as adding to his repertoire of a musical. Conquest. So yeah, let's see what he got.
Cool. And also, just I wanted to mention the reason that I wasn't planning on doing To Pimp a Butterfly. Mm-hmm. I had a couple other albums I was going to play.
Oh.
But with the recent news of Kendrick Lamar about to drop a brand new album in the next couple
saw
weeks.
That.
Yep. And I love that you're seeing rap news and you're like sending it to me. That's so cool.
Hey, Rod, it didn't. So you didn't know about that, huh?
No, I definitely knew before you
said. Oh, you
it
did?
To me.
Oh, but, you already knew. Okay. I thought I was up on one on you. Okay, all right.
But
all right.
It was still cool because that was like just such the buzz talk of the day. And then for you to see that and send it to me, I thought that was awesome. But so yeah, Kendrick is dropping his newest album, and it's titled Mr. Morale and the Big Steppers. So I'm excited. Yeah, I have no idea what this might mean.
Who are the Big Steppers?
We are.
Oh, so you don't? Okay.
I have no idea.
All right, I thought that might have been part of his crew, like you know, 50 had his
the G Unit. Yeah,
G Unit. Yeah, okay.
No, it's just an album title, and I have no idea who this character Mr. Morale is. I'm assuming it's going to be him, but we'll get into that later. I wanted to listen to this because when that album comes out, I think we should do like a blind reaction to the new album where I haven't heard it either.
Okay.
And we both hear it for the same time.
Oh, that's cool.
For the first time at the same time.
That would be nice.
So that's going to be really hard for me because it comes out on a Friday. And usually when stuff comes out on a Friday, I listen to it as soon as it comes out. Especially something like
Kendrick Lamar. You got to hold back. You got to show some discipline.
Yeah, it's going to be really hard. But I'm going to do my best not to listen to it.
All right.
And we're going to have to make sure we record as soon as it comes out. All right. So cool. We are going to listen to Pimp a Butterfly. And then next week, we're going to listen to his next album, Damn. Mm-hmm. And then the week after that, the album releases, and we'll be able to listen to that.
They got a video where they got a butterfly walking around on the corner. And Lamar, Kendrick Lamar's out there. Hey!
Better have my money.
Where my money at? Butterfly.
Such a dad joke. No.
It was a funny dad joke, though. For real. For real. You know it was.
I love it. All right, cool. So, just a little background. It's like I said, it's a album that he released. It's his third studio album by Kendrick Lamar. It was released March 15th, 2015 by Top Dog Entertainment, as well as Aftermath and Interscope. So if you'll remember, that is also the label that 50 Cent and Eminem dropped their music through, Aftermath and Interscope. Mm-hmm. The album was recorded throughout the United States. It has production from Pharrell Williams, Boy Wonder, Knowledge, Thundercat, Taz Arnold, Terrace Martin, and Soundwave. Primarily a hip-hop album, To Pimp a Butterfly incorporates numerous other musical styles spanning the history of African-American music, most prominently jazz, funk, and soul. Lyrically, it features political commentary and personal themes concerning African-American culture, racial inequality, depression, institutional discrimination. And this thematic direction was inspired by Lamar's tour of historic sites during his visit to South Africa, such as Nelson Mandela's jail cell on Robben Island. So it was a successful album. It sold 324,000 copies in its first week. It debuted at number one, sold a ton of records. It's gone platinum. It's got the Pulitzer, all that good stuff. We're going to get right into To Pimp a Butterfly. The first track here is Wesley's Theory. Featuring George Clinton and Thundercat. And this one is produced by Flippa, Flying Lotus, Soundwave, and Thundercat. So this is going to pretty much establish the theme. This is the first part. Like I was telling you, it's kind of broken down into four different parts. So this is the first track of Part one, Wesley's Theory. Here we go.
Okay.
Two time, too slow. Plan them on everything, plan them on word rate. Married to the game at a bad bitch shows. When I get signed on me, I'ma buy strap. Straight from the CIA, set it on my lap. Take a few M16s to the hood. Pass them all out on the black ones, good. I'ma put the cop to swap me by the White House. Republican run up, get socked out. Hit the press with a Cuban link on my neck. Uneducated, but I got $1 million check like that.
We should never pay, we should never pay. Niggas money, go back home.
I'm on your dog. Motherfucker, you can live at the mall. I know you're kind, that's why I'm kind.
Don't have receipts,
oh man, that's fine.
Pay me later, wear those gaiters. Cliche and say fuck your haters.
I can see the bother in you, I can see the dollar in you. Little white lies, but it's no white collar in you. But it's whatever though, because I'm still following you. Because you make me live forever, baby. Count it all together, baby. Then hit the register and make me feel better, baby. This was the night how Wesley sniped your ass before 35.
Yeah, looking down is quite a drop. Looking good when you're on top. Better metaphors, leaving metaphors metaphysically in a state of euphoria.
All right, that is the conclusion of track number one, Wesley's Theory, featuring George Clinton, Thundercat, produced by Thundercat. What'd you think about that one, Dad?
Very interesting. It was good. It was to me. I like the arrangements. I like the production. I liked the message. It was kind of like you had to really follow it close to try to figure out what he was saying. But in the long run, he pretty much captured it all up. But see, with the little touch of George Clinton in there and the musical part of it, it was good. It was so different from what I've, even from the first one we heard.
Yeah.
It was really different. So it like, you want to kind of bounce to it, but at the same time, it pulls you in where you just like, okay, I just won't listen.
Yes, you know, see what he's talking about. Yeah.
So I liked it. It was a good song.
Okay.
It wasn't disappointing, that's for sure.
Cool. So you liked the music and kind of the funk elements to it.
Right. George Clinton. With the George Clinton. Yeah. You know, every time it comes to funk, that's my thing. Funk.
Yeah.
You know, so, yeah.
Did you pick up on any of kind of like the theme of what he was kind of talking about?
Well, he was going into a political, you know, some things and, you know, like I said, this song right here, I'll probably want to listen to it like about three times to just kind of really catch everything that he was saying in one time. This brother's deep, man.
Very much so. So something that I haven't done too much on the other albums is really kind of gone in depth and try to like explaining. Like, but I think that with this project being like so just intricate and thematic, it's very on theme. I do have a deeper understanding of it, so maybe if I can kind of briefly explain. So on this track, verse one, he's coming in, he's talking from his own perspective, basically saying how he, you know, when I get signed, I'm gonna act a fool, I'm gonna get a secretary for my homies, and we're gonna spend our money, and I can't wait to go platinum and doing all this and that.
Right.
So that's him being like the caterpillar with this mindset of, I'm going to just use my talents to get on and kind of shit on my haters and do all that stuff. Right. And then we get introduced to his, basically like the antagonist of the story, which is Uncle Sam in that second verse. And he's actually rapping from Uncle Sam's, this character that he's created, his perspective, and he's saying, what do you want, a house, a car, 40 acres and a mule, a guitar, blah, blah, blah. And he's offering all these riches and all these things, but at what cost?
Right.
Okay. So that's basically what this one is about.
A free lunch. Yeah.
Exactly. Okay. And then there's even like a line like, we should never gay you niggas money, go back home.
Right. Yeah.
You know, and that's kind of like tying into the theme. And then even the hook, or like the beginning bridge or whatever, where he's saying, at first I did love you, but now I just wanna late nights thinking of you. So at first music was like something that he loved and appreciated and did it for the passion. But now the music, it's kind of like it's pimping him and he's pimping it, and it's become more of a less pure.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right. Right. He's looking at it from a different, wholly new point of view, is what he's saying. As when he first went into it, he was just like for the pure love of it. I get it.
Cool. Awesome. So we'll go ahead and roll into track number two. This one is titled For Free. And And
For Free
is an interlude. It's produced by Terrace Martin, a very talented musician and saxophone player.
Oh, okay.
And building on the metaphor drawn in Wesley's theory, we find Kendrick continuing to fall victim to the pimps of the record industry. This interlude is very similar to the song Tramp by Otis Redding, also featuring a girl dissing our favorite artists. So yeah, this is just kind of him building on the theme of, you know, the record business and the government.
Tramp,
you remember that one?
Yeah.
Cool. So it's kind of got some similarities to that. So here is For Free.
Damn. I'm looking at the first line.
God's gift to earth. You off. What the fuck is really going on?
Dang. This dick ain't free. You looking at me like it ain't a receipt, like I never made ends meet, eating your leftovers and raw meat. This dick ain't free. Living in captivity, raised my cap salary, celery, telling me green is all I need. Evidently, all I seen was spam and raw sardines. This dick ain't free. I mean, baby, you really think we could make a baby name Mercedes without a Mercedes Benz and 24-inch rims, 5% tint and air conditioning vents? Hell fucking no. This dick ain't free. I need 40 acres and a mule, not a 40 ounce and a pit bull. Bullshit. Matador, knocking, let him in. Who's that genitals best friend? This dick ain't free. Now fuck you up. You ain't no king.
Oh, right. That is track number 2, For Free Interlude. What'd you think about that one, Dad?
I liked it. I liked that jazzy feel to it. It was like you entering into a smoke. You enter into a smoke field room of, you know, jazz musicians. It just, you know, for a jam session, it gave you that kind of feel to the music. I don't know where, I'm still trying to decipher the message on this, though. I mean, he's like, you know, he started out, fuck you, motherfucker, your whole head. That chick, whoever she was, she went off on somebody. And then he was just like, he set the record straight. This dick ain't free. And, you know, he's like, explain it to her ass. Yeah. You know, this ain't free. And then he just broke it down to her. But I'm okay, so I'm assuming at one point when we get, as the album progresses, this message is going to become clearer to me.
Okay, so it kind of builds on to the narrative from the first track, how he feels like he's being pimped by the industry or the country or whatever. And so she says at the end, I'm going to get my Uncle Sam to mess you up.
Uh-huh.
So I'm assuming that
she's
her character, I'm assuming her character is like a metaphor for like America.
Right.
Like she's like, you know, she's dissing him. She's telling him, you're not nothing if you don't have these things, mm-hmm. if you don't have this status, you ain't shit.
Mm-hmm.
You off brand, my other dude.
Oh,
is,
yeah, that was cold right there. Yeah, my other dude is on it. You ain't, you off or something. I'm like, damn, she bold.
So she's going off on him, kind of telling him himself, you know, basically just killing his self worth. Then he comes back and says, no, I'm worth this, I'm worth that.
Mm-hmm.
And he's explaining his worth, but it's also still coming off in like a materialistic way.
Right.
You know, he's saying that he's worth something, and but it's really, you know, based on materials and not actually like being a good person and things like that. So I think this is just kind of building on.
Hey, I like that line right there. You really think we can make a baby named Mercedes without a Mercedes Benz?
24-inch rims. Yeah, exactly. And so that's kind of like touching on like the materialism,
right.
And yeah, all of this.
Oh, the other part where I liked that other part too. He said he said something about a pit bull.
I need 40 acres and a mule, not a 40 ounce and a pit bull.
Yeah, 40 ounce and a pit bull. Right. And I was like, oh damn.
Yeah. that's a really good line.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean his lyrical, he just goes crazy on here, but yeah. Not to like go into too much detail. That I feel like he's just kind of carrying on that same theme.
Okay.
It's like he's still the caterpillar. He's still got this worldly view, mm-hmm. materialistic view. He's got this success, and he's, you know, finding out that even though you have success, that doesn't, like, solve all your problems.
Right.
You know, you he's still fighting with himself.
Okay.
Okay. So now she, yeah, at the end of this song, she says, I'm going to get my Uncle Sam to fuck you up. You ain't no king. And then it rolls into the next track, which is track number 3. It is titled King Kunta.
As in Kunta Kinte.
Correct. This one is produced by Soundwave and Terrace Martin. This is track 3. King Kunta is the main character in the novel Roots. You know that.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so this is just, he's going to continue on with this theme, and we'll talk about it more after you hear the song.
Okay.
King Kunta.
I got a bone to pick.
Uh-oh.
I don't want you monkey mouth motherfucker sitting in my throne again.
Hey, nigga, what's
happening?
I'm
mad. But I ain't stressing. True friends. One question. Where you and I was walking. Now I run a game, got the whole world talking. King Kunta, everybody wanna cut the legs off him. Kunta, black man taking no losses.
Oh yeah.
Bitch, where you and I was walking. Now I run a game, got the whole world talking. King Kunta, everybody wanna cut the legs off him. When you got the yams.
What's the yams?
Oh, I swore I wouldn't tell. But most of y'all share bars like you got the bottle bunk in a two-man sale.
A two-man sale.
Something's in the water.
Something's in the water.
Nice.
And if I got a brown nose for some gold, then I'd rather be a bum than a motherfucking ball.
Oh yeah.
Bitch, where you and I was walking. Now I run a game, got the whole world talking. King Kunta, everybody wanna cut the legs off him.
King Kunta,
black man taking no losses.
Oh yeah.
Bitch, where you and I was walking. Now I run a game, got the whole world talking. King Kunta, everybody wanna cut the legs off him.
King Kunta,
you got the yams.
What's the yams?
The yam brought it out of Richard Pryor. Manipulated Bill Clinton with desires. 24/7, 365 days times 2. I was contemplating getting off stage just to go back to the hood, see my enemy and say,
oh yeah.
Bitch, where you and I was walking. Now I run a game, got the whole world talking. King Kunta, everybody wanna cut the legs off him.
King Kunta,
black man taking no losses.
Oh yeah.
Bitch, where you and I was walking. Now I run a game, got the whole world talking. King Kunta, everybody wanna cut the legs off him.
Goat mouth mammy fuck.
I was gonna kill a couple rappers, but they did it to themselves. Everybody's suicidal, they didn't even need my help. This shit is elementary, I'd probably go to jail if I shoot at your identity and bound behind them. Life ain't shit, but a fat vagina screaming, Annie, are you okay? Annie, are you okay? Lieutenant with
Jack
the gold
bang.
Straight from the bottom, Mr. Belly at a beast. From a peasant to a prince to a motherfucking king.
Oh yeah?
Bitch, where you and I was.
By the time you hear the next pop, the funk shall be within you.
Now I run the game, got the whole world talking. King Kunta, everybody wanna cut the legs off.
King Kunta,
black man taking.
I like
notice.
That.
Oh, yeah. Where you and I was walking. Now I run the game, got the whole world talking. King Kunta, everybody wanna cut the legs off.
Nothing but the funk, the whole funk. No, this is it, right?
Man, if I need the funk, you gon' take it.
Yeah.
We want the funk.
I remember you was conflicted. Misusing your influence.
All right.
Okay, that's that poem right there.
That's that poem we talked about. I remember you was conflicted, misusing your influence. That is track number 3, King Kunta. What'd you think about that one, Dad?
So now, from what I'm gathering now, he's this caterpillar that is now evolving.
Okay.
And he's going into the cocoon.
Okay.
So he's realizing that in the beginning his aspirations were would be shallow.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like you said, you talked about him. He emphasized immaterial things and mm-hmm. the things that he thought was important to him in the beginning, and now he's starting to see that there's a higher level of achievement, something more rewarding for him. And so he's right at that cusp of transitioning.
Yeah, I think he is getting towards a transition, but he's still pretty...
still green.
He's still very early in his transformation. Mm. And this one, he's kind of... He's basically saying he's rich. He just got back to L.A., and now he's walking around talking shit to people.
Yeah, pretty much.
Where was you when I was walking?
Yeah.
Now I run the gang of the whole world talking, King Kunta. Like, he's like, kind of like...
But I get that. I mean, you know, judging from this story he's trying to tell, he had to get that out. You know what I mean? He had to get that out. He had to talk shit to people, you know, because that was part of, you know,
yeah,
you know what I mean?
The relief. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Also, it should be noted that King Kunta is kind of like, it's like a oxymoron, because it's like king, he's still a king. He's a king because he's, you know, reached this amount of success, but he's still being treated like a slave, you know, in the industry and still being controlled.
What was he talking about when he was talking about, he kept referring to cut the legs off or something like that? Cut
now run the game, got the, everybody want to cut the legs off him. Yeah.
Okay. So they're just trying to bring him down. Is that what he's saying?
Exactly. Okay. And it's kind of a reference to, you know, Kunta Kinte got his foot chopped off. In the movie. So, yeah, exactly. Like, now he runs the game. Everybody wants to cut his foot off. Yeah, I remember Roots. For sure.
Okay.
And so, yeah, it's like, He's still in that mindset of just consuming, shitting on my haters, you know. Mm-hmm. There's another line I thought that was interesting. He's talking about the yams.
Yeah, that was another thing. What's the yam?
So he says the yams brought it out of Richard Pryor. I think he's referring to like when Richard Pryor kind of went crazy and like he set himself on fire.
What's he trying to? I think what was he doing when crack was around or was very popular? I think Richard Pryor was trying to smoke some crack and got set his
he set himself on fire.
I don't know what it was. Yeah, I got to go back and check out what actually happened with that with Richard Pryor. But yeah, manipulated Bill Clinton with desires.
So
I don't know.
Yeah, I guess like Bill Clinton being like a presidential figure, and then you know having
the scandal,
whole scandal of the Monica Lewinsky thing. So 24/7, 365 days too. I was contemplating getting off stage just to go back to the hood and see my enemy and say. So he's like, he's going through all the success and he's at this high and he can't wait to get off stage just to go back home and be like, bitch, where was you when I was walking?
Right.
Like you shouldn't even be focused on.
Yeah,
going back and gloating and stuff. You're on top of the world.
Oh, but he's got to, man. I mean, he's got a bone to pick. He's really got a bone to pick. He's got to get it off his chest.
Well, that's what he says.
I
pick.
I'll be like, nah. You know, well, look at y'all fools. You know.
Well, that's exactly where he's at right now. Kind of, you know, and that's where the poem starts here. I remember you was conflicted, misusing your influence. Mm.
I gotta get one or two in.
Yeah, I'm gonna just let you do it.
No, you keep doing it.
All right. So that was King Kunta. We listened to track number 3. Kendrick's kind of still in his kind of materialistic and consumption bag. We'll go ahead and move into Institutionalized. And oh yeah, you guys, I also shared with my dad this. This To Pimp a Butterfly map that Dissect Podcast did. Shout out to Dissect Podcast. I listened to this whole podcast to prepare for this episode with my dad, just so I had a little bit more context about the album. But wow, what a dope podcast. If you never listened to it and you love this album, you should check it out. This is not sponsored. They are dope. So shout out to Dissect Podcast. But anyway, on this map, we have completed Act 1. Which is titled Pimped by Consumption, all those themes of exploitation, American capitalism, materialism, and ego were part 1. So now we're moving into Act 2, which is Cocooned. So this is tracks number 4 and 5, Institutionalized and These Walls. So we'll go ahead and move into track number 5, Institutionalized. This one's featuring Bilal, Anna Wise, and Snoop Dogg. You know that guy, right?
Yeah, something like that. No.
Yeah, they still want us to listen to Doggy Style.
Is that right?
Yeah, we got to get to that.
Is that a good one?
Doggy Style's fire.
Is it?
For sure.
Okay.
Track number four, Institutionalized, Bilal, Anna Wise, Snoop Dogg, and is produced by Tommy Black and Rocky. Or Rocky, yeah. All right, here we go. Institutionalized.
What money got to do with it? When I don't know the full definition of a rap image. I'm trapped inside the ghetto and I ain't proud to admit it. Institutionalized, so I keep running back for a visit. Hold up. Get it back.
Master, take the chains off me.
A box of chocolate, quid pro quo, something for something, that's the obvious. Oh shit, flow so sick, don't you swallow it. Biting my style, your salmonella poison positive. I can just alleviate the rap industry politics. Milk the game up, no jury. I should've listened what my grandmama said to me.
Shit don't change until you get up and wash your ass, nigga. Shit don't change until you get up and wash your ass. Boy, shit don't change to you. Get up and wash your ass, nigga. Oh, now, slow down.
Once upon a time in a city so divine called Westside Compton, there stood a little nigga. He was 5 foot something. God bless the kid.
Boy, when I see him with the bird deal on the floor, now Kendrick know they're your co-workers. But this go take a lot for this pistol go cold turkey. Now I can watch his watch on the TV and be okay. But see, I'm on the clock with that watch landing in LA. Remember, steal from the rich and giving it back to the poor. Well, that's me at these awards.
I guess my grandmama was warning the boy. She said,
shit don't change until you get up and wash your ass, nigga. Shit don't change until you get up and wash your ass. Boy, shit don't change
for your service.
All right, that is track number four, Institutionalized. What'd you think about that one, Dad?
I really like the whole vibe of that song, man. The sound effects and all of that, man, I like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Institutionalized. And Snoop had a nice little, you know, his little run in that, and I like that too. Good song.
Yeah, lots of jazzy sounds in that one. The clarinet just going crazy, and there's flute in there, just flute solos.
Mm-hmm.
And the music is super cool. It's like got like a dope, like hip hop beat to it, but it's like all those jazz elements in the background, and it even like starts off with like a separate part,
mm-hmm.
and then it kind of the beat switches.
Yeah, I like that switch up too, man. This guy, I mean, listen to him. It's like, I know he's a rapper and everything, and he's got a nice flow,
mm-hmm.
Choice of words and stuff. You know, play on words and stuff like that. You could tell he's a deep thinking individual. But different style, man, definitely, and I like it. I see why people are crazy about him, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Did you happen to pick up on any of the storyline of this one?
Yeah, kind of. I mean, I was just like...
So basically the story behind this one is Kendrick, he's like, he had come back to Compton and King Kunta, and he's walking around kind of flexing himself.
Mm.
Then he goes to the BET Awards, and he takes some friends with him. And, you know, instead of just enjoying themselves, his friends from the hood,
they want to rob everybody.
They want to rob everybody at the award
shows. Yeah, I got that part. Everybody, all these rollies, they want to take all of, I got that part of it.
So that's pretty much the gist of this.
What was throwing me off was that he kept reflecting back to when he was saying something like he was a little boy, he was 5 foot something.
Mm-hmm.
So is he going back and forth in his memory of Compton?
Yeah, I would say so. Yeah, I think kind of Snoop is saying, Snoop is just kind of giving it that narrative. Once upon a time, there was a little Kendrick, and you know, he was talented, but still under the neighborhood's mentality.
Right.
You know, and then it says something about you can't take the hood out the homie.
Yeah, that's right.
You take the homie out the hood, but you can't take the hood out the homie.
Yeah.
So basically, it's just carrying on with the storyline. Is this part is cocooned, and it's like you're like stuck in your environment in the way that it brought you up. You can take your homies out of the hood, and they still want to rob people.
So did that actually happen, you think? Or what? I mean, you know, because I could see something like that. He got his boys with him. They hanging out. He's like trying to show off and stuff. You know, this is what my life is about. And then he bring his boys, and then the boys is checking everybody like, gee, jack this dude
I'm finna come up.
You got to put a leash on him. Man. Don't be robbing nobody up in here. Okay. All right.
I mean,
nice little story.
He kills it, too. To it. Yeah. Like when he's talking in their from their perspective, he's saying, you know, what am I supposed to do when I'm looking at walking licks? Like people just look like a come up, and he talks about how it's their defense mechanism. I don't know. He just breaks this down.
Yeah, he does
so well. What did you think about the passage, like the hook part, the shit don't change and. Till you get up and wash your ass.
Oh yeah. That's you know what? That was like an old school kind of, you know, I guess some words of wisdom that would be passed down, you know, to you from like your grandmother or something like that. And it's true. It's true. Shit don't change. You get up and wash your head, cause that's the first thing you do when you get up in the morning. You gotta get up in the morning.
Yeah.
And before you get out and handle some business. You got to wash your ass before you go out the door. You know, so shit don't change unless you get up out of that bed, wash your ass, and then go, you know, handle your business.
For sure.
So I get that part.
Dope. Okay, cool. So, yeah, we've moved on to the second act. This is the cocooned act. And he's kind of explaining how he's, you know, the things around him that, you know, affect him, that he's fighting against, and also that are ultimately going to change him and lead him to making a change.
All right.
So we'll go ahead and move into the next track here, which is titled These Walls. And this song's dope. Maybe I'll try this. So this song is basically Kendrick is going to be talking from his perspective in the first verse. Then he's going to be talking from the female perspective of a woman that he's going to have relationships with. And then he's going to reveal that this woman that he's had a relationship with is from revenge. Like he was using his influence to get revenge, and the revenge was having relationships with this
woman. Okay.
Cool. So just a little bit of background. Maybe... because I really want you to, like, be able to, like...
Okay. Follow it.
You're picking up, and I'm explaining it, and I think, you know, as we move along, it'll... But, yeah, anyway, I don't know. I'm just trying different stuff.
Okay.
Cool. So, These Walls.
All right.
And this is produced by Thundercat, as well as Terrace Martin and Rance and Soundwave, and it features Anna Wise, Bilal, and Thundercat.
All right.
I remember you was conflicted. Misusing your influence.
Oh, there's that phrase.
Sometimes I did the same.
So remember that phrase, misusing your influence.
To play, she plays only when you
That's how he's rolling.
Yeah.
I'd rather diss him, I'd rather call on you, put your wall up. Cause when I come around, demolition go.
Crush.
Thundercat, Soundwave, Terrace Martin. His production team is crazy.
Nice.
If your walls can talk, they tell you it's too late. Your destiny accepted your fate. Put accessories and stash them on the yard. Take the recipe, the Bible, and God. Wall telling you that commissary is low. Race wars happening, no calling CO. No calling your mother to save you. Homies to say you're irreptible, not acceptable. Your behavior sent me to board like
nice,
a killer that turned snitch. Wars is to a deep depression. Found myself screaming in the hotel room.
All right, that concludes These Walls. What'd you think about that one, Dad?
That was a nice song.
Yeah.
It's got a nice beat. It's got a nice message. Basically, this brother's, from what I got from him, this is just him describing him sexing this girl down.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Right.
If these walls could talk,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, I know what he's talking about.
But
he was like, you know, but... Yeah, man, his words are so colorful and descriptive, and man, the metaphors, man, it's
literally everything on here is a metaphor.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, even these walls,
you could take it in so many different ways,
right?
You know.
So he's got in the first verse, he's like talking about the water, you know, all the you know.
Right.
You know, no boat I float better than he would, no life jacket, mm-hmm. I'm not God of Nazareth, mm-hmm. You know. So he's likening her to being turning on with the water and everything like that.
Right.
And then even these walls, yeah, it's talking about like her walls.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's also like a metaphor of the fact that the dude that's in prison.
Yep, exactly.
Is locked behind the walls.
Yep.
And then that third verse where it's almost like he's talking directly to the guy in prison.
Oh, he was.
Because the dude.
I think he was.
So the dude that he's talking about is the one that killed his homie in Good Kid, Mad City.
Okay.
He went to prison. He ends up going to prison. And
he's getting on with his girl.
With his girl.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's part of the To Pimp a Butterfly because he's using
his influence.
His influence. And
because she wouldn't have got with him unless he was who he was.
Exactly.
So he's using his influence to get back
and
at
he's
this dude.
Full of resentment. Mm-hmm. You see.
I get
okay,
it.
Okay. Just walk with us.
Yeah.
This is every single part of this is so well thought out. It's insane. But yeah, awesome lyrical passages through here. This is probably one of the most enjoyable songs on here. I just love King Kunta is really dope. Mm-hmm. That's a cool upbeat song.
Oh man, the arrangements was amazing, man.
But yeah, this one is just like that groovy R&B mm-hmm. kind of mm-hmm. sexy vibe. Mm-hmm. But it's just so incredibly deep. So, and it's like you can really just listen to it without even thinking about none of that. But
right.
then when you actually think about what he's doing here, it just.
I like his flow when he raps, man.
Yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. he kind of slows it up sometimes and then he'll just not slow it up, but kind of hesitate mm-hmm. and then go boom. And then it's all smooth.
Yeah.
Constant.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. I like that, man. He's got a nice side. He's got a nice style.
Dope.
It's totally unique.
Dope.
Yeah.
All right, I'm just going to go back to the poem part on here so it can roll into the next song because it's pretty relevant.
Okay.
The next track is titled You.
Excuse me. You.
Track number 6 is titled You.
Okay.
And so this is basically he wakes up in a hotel room. This is part of the, you know, just continuing the narrative. Mm-hmm. And he states that at the end of this poem, so it kind of just rolls into it. So I'll just play it. This one is You, produced by Taz Arnold, Warai, and Soundwave, and no featured artists on here, all Kendrick.
Abusing my power full of resentment.
There you go.
Resentment that turned into a deep depression. Mm-hmm. Found myself screaming in the hotel room.
Watching anonymous strangers telling me that I'm yours, but you ain't
ashamed of me. Yes, I hate you.
Track number 6, You. What'd you think about that one, Dad?
Man, that was deep, man. What's he talking about, the dad?
No.
What's he talking about? I mean, he's like, you know, talking about a lot of stuff with somebody else's fault, though. Was that?
He's talking to himself.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He's in the mirror. He's in a hotel room in a mirror.
I remember I got that part with his housekeeping, and he's in there talking. So, mm-hmm. And then I did see the reference about the mirror.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. So
he's blaming himself for some things.
For a lot of things. Yeah. Okay. So, another recurring theme.
He's pretty hard on himself then.
The misusing your influence. So he's talking in the first verse, he talks about how his little sister got pregnant and. Where were your antenna? She's just a teenager. Where's that influence that you speak of? You got all these hundreds of thousands of fans, but you couldn't even reach her. You know, mm-hmm. So he's beating himself up about that. He's beating himself up about.
He said something about what was that? Going somewhere? Hospital? Something about a hospital visit?
Yeah. So while he was on tour in like 2013, he had lost 3 homies, like close homies, from Compton, and he didn't make it home to visit him in the hospital. He ended up dying. So you even FaceTimed instead of a hospital visit. Guess you thought he'd recover well. Third surgery, they couldn't stop the bleeding for real. Then he died. God himself will say, "You fucking failed. You ain't try." I mean, he's beating himself down. I mean, he's depressed. He's
all for the sake of fame and fortune.
Right.
So, okay, all right. Man, this dude is, man, he's so deep in all these metaphors, man. I'm really having a struggle with trying to, you know.
Yeah.
See where he's coming from. You know, you almost really, this right here, this album right here, you got to listen to it, like, and for you to really get the gist of it, this would be one of those albums, man, you got to hear it like 5 or 6 times.
You'd have to hear this album probably way more than that. That.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Because I was giving it
I'm telling you, this came out 2015, so it's been 7 years.
Uh-huh.
I've listened to this album quite a bit. I've read a lot of things about it. I've never fully grasped it
mm-hmm.
until I just like listened to that podcast.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
There are so many themes and stuff that I completely missed. Parts of this story, parts of this narrative that I just love the music. I hear his pain and his passion and
right.
I hear what he's saying, but I'm not tying all this stuff together.
And now you are. And
now I am.
But see, you had the advantage to listen to the podcast, so you like asking me and you. And when I'm saying certain stuff that I'm thinking I'm hearing, mm-hmm. and you looking at me like,
well, no, it's interesting to hear you interpret it the way you're interpreting it, and I'm glad that I kind of know now that
so you can explain it to you. I need that.
But I'm glad you're. You know, picking out some of the stuff. So yeah, like
I'm kind of like picking points, mm-hmm. and I think some of the points I'm picking is like, okay, yeah, I might be on track, but man, when you start unpeeling the layers of this thing right here, man, of all his songs right now so far I've heard, man, there's so much to it.
So much to it, yeah. And there's even more to it that is like, so this beginning passage where he's saying loving you is complicated, he's mm-hmm. kind of really frantically saying that. So that is actually from like a Tupac poem or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
That's a Tupac reference.
Okay.
And Kendrick is very intentional in everything that he does on this album, so I just wanted to point that out.
Oh, okay.
That is from a Tupac something, poem or something.
All right, so when I listen to it again, at least when I know to get to that point.
Yeah.
Where he's referencing. Okay.
Cool. So yeah, so he's just completely engulfed in depression. It sounds like he's got suicidal thoughts.
I remember that part too. See, suicidal weakness. So, yeah, that's deep.
This is still in that cocoon part. He's kind of just dealing with. So first he was dealing with his homies, can't take the hood out the homie. Then you're dealing with his revenge and his resentment, you know, getting with the baby mom, and trying to seek revenge on the dude that killed his homie. And now he's in a hotel room. At this point, he's hit rock bottom in the album.
Okay.
So this is, I would say, the bottom.
Right.
You know, as far as like a story goes, a storyline,
right,
you know?
Right.
So our character has hit rock bottom. Next track is titled All Right. And this is track number 7. This one is produced by Soundwave as well as Pharrell Williams.
Ah.
Our good guy Pharrell. We love Pharrell
high
beats.
High notes singing in this. Yeah. So falsetto.
Definitely going to hear some Pharrell in here.
Right.
Featuring Pharrell as well. This is, like I said, so what we just heard was the very, very bottom of the album, the rock bottom of our character. So here we go. All right.
All's my life I has to fight, nigga. All's my life I. Hard times like, yeah. Bad trips like, yeah. Nazareth, I'm fucked up, homie. You fucked up. But if God got us, then we gon' be all right. And when I wake up, I recognize you looking at me for the pay cut. Bahamas, I be looking at you from the face down. One Mac 11, even boom with the bass down. Skimming, and let me tell you about my life. Painkillers only put me in the twilight. With pretty pussy and Benjamin is the highlight. I tell my mama I love her, but this what I like. Lord knows, 20 of them in my Chevy. Tell them all to come and get me, reaping everything I sow. So my karma come in heaven, no preliminary hearings on my record. I'm a motherfucking gangster in silence for the record. Tell the world I know it's me. Boys and girls, I think inside my face is all day. Won't you please believe when I say, when you know it ain't no Rico digging in my pocket.
been a prophet, man, I'm about to feed you every day my logic. Get another dollar just to keep you in the presence of your Chico. I don't talk about it, be about it, every day I seek you. If I got it, then you know you got it, heaven, I can reach you. Pet dog, my dog, that's all. Big back and chat, I trap the bag for y'all. I rap, I black on tracks, so rest assured. My rights, my wrongs, I write till I'm right with God.
When you know,
we've been nerving down before. Nigga, when our pride was low, looking at the world like, where do we go? Nigga,
nights in my prayers.
I remember you was conflicted.
All right, that is track number 8, 7, 8.
He's talking himself up on this one.
All right, yes.
And he's like, you know, okay, I'm coming out of this funk. Mm-hmm. We're going to be all right. Mm-hmm. Lucy surrounded him. I guess he's referring to Lucifer.
Correct.
Okay, so he got this evil aura all around him. He feels it, but he's going to be all right because he's gonna break through all of that. Yeah,
for sure, absolutely. Just a little more background on this song as well. Like, this came out around the time in 2015 where it was just like a bunch of high profile police shootings of unarmed black people.
Mm-hmm.
Like Sandra Bland, Tamir Rice, and Mike Brown, and just like all this slew of like months leading up to this. This actually ended up becoming like the unofficial anthem for the Black Lives Matter movement, and it just took on a lot of separate legs from the album.
Mm-hmm.
Just because of the time and just everything that was going on in the country.
Right.
Also notably about the song, as far as the narrative of the album, you're right on point with Lucy. That's another character or antagonist in this mm-hmm. narrative. So Lucy's like offering him money and cars and all right. that stuff. And he's kind of looking at it a little differently than the way he was looking at it
before
when he was talking with Uncle Sam.
Right.
So I think you can kind of see his bit of progression. And
he's slowly trying to pull himself up. You know, he's trying to get out of that fog. You know, I could definitely see that.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a good song. I like it, and everything still had this jazzy sound to it, man. I love the pianos, the horn. He uses a lot of wind instruments.
Mm-hmm.
This guy, man.
Yeah.
We'll be all right. Yeah, I like that, man.
Yeah, that's a good jam. You like the Pharrell's hook on there?
Yeah. I always like Pharrell, man. It's when you told me Pharrell was gonna be on here though, I never seemed like Pharrell's songs are move faster,
mm-hmm.
and they're more like upbeat. And I was thinking this was gonna be like one of those songs on this album like that.
But yeah.
It was definitely all Lamar.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Even
for
though
sure.
Pharrell was on it, mm-hmm. you know. So yeah, he didn't. Pharrell didn't have a big influence on this. He just put his little part in there, but mm-hmm. it stayed strictly Lamar.
Yeah, know? For sure. Kendrick, absolutely just. You know, he uses the artist that he collabed with on this album. He used mm-hmm. them as accessories to help yeah. the story.
Mm-hmm.
He never like leans on them to like
help him along.
Yeah. This is all him.
Oh, he's gonna yeah. make sure it's authentically him.
For sure.
Yeah, I got it.
All right. So yeah. So he's in the hotel room. He wakes up the next day. He's feeling got a new energy, and then we come to the next song, which is Mama. In the last one of the last lines of this song, he says he's gonna go back home.
Excuse me.
Hold on.
There's another one after that, isn't there?
Yeah, I thought. Oh yeah. After All Right is For Sale. My bad. Track number 8, For Sale.
Us interlude.
Another interlude here. And this one is produced by Taz Arnold, Soundwave, and Terrace Martin.
Mm-hmm.
Track number 8, For Sale. Oh, so so on For Sale, now mm-hmm. we've got Lucy. He's rapping in the perspective of Lucy.
Okay.
Got it. All right. For Sale interlude. What'd you think about that one, Dad?
It was having some serious mental struggles, man. Conflicting thoughts. He was going through it, man. Almost like he was going through some kind of withdrawal. Mm. You know what I mean? But it seems like he's just like breaking free from it, though. He's like, I don't care. I know what's happening around me. I see the evil around me, but I'm gonna come through it all.
Yeah.
Yeah. Lucy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I look at this song kind of like it feels kind of like a dream sequence.
Mm-hmm.
Like the way the instruments sound and stuff. And it's like he's kind of having this like go back and forth,
mm-hmm,
with Lucy, and maybe like his conscience telling him like,
mm-hmm,
he shouldn't fall for it and stuff.
Yeah, he's doing a good job of it because he, like I said, he's seeing the light. He's seeing it, and then at the end, he said he finally started, you know, realizing he's going home now.
Mm-hmm.
So he's pretty much, you know, I think he's getting himself together. He's going to head home,
mm-hmm,
and start tightening up his game.
Cool. All right, so For Sale, that was For Sale. So we're in Act 3 right now, and Act 3 is his, yeah, you're right on the money with it. His wings, mm-hmm, are emerging,
mm-hmm,
from the cocoon. Like he's smartening up, you know. He's learning how to, you know, defeat his evils and stuff like that. So the next track here is titled Mama, and this one is produced by Taz Arnold and Knowledge. Track number 9. And yeah, he's just continuing on his personal growth and all that good stuff.
It's Knowledge. He wasn't on any of the prior songs, was he?
I don't believe so.
Yeah.
I don't think so. He's a producer, listed as a producer on here. So
okay.
And then so yeah, we just had another portion of that poem again, and there was a couple more lines added, and he says he's gonna go back home, and here we go.
Oh shit, I need that.
So
I need that sloppy. That sloppy.
Yo.
Like a Chevy in quicksand. Yeah. That sloppy.
So This feeling is unmatched. This feeling is brought to you by adrenaline and good rap. Black penitent, bar cap.
West.
We don't share the same synonym, far back.
West.
Been in it before internet had new acts. Mimicking radio's nemesis may be whack. My innocence limited, the experience lacked. Innocence turned attraction, pivoting rappers, finishing fraction while writing blue magic. Thank God for rap. I would say it got me a plaque, but what's better than that? The fact it brought me back home.
Later. We've been waiting for you.
I know everything. Know myself, I know morality, spirituality, good and bad health. I know fatality, my haunch. I know everything. I know Compton, I know street shit, I know shit that's conscious. I know everything. I know lawyers, advertisement, and sponsors. I know the price of life, I'm knowing how much it's worth. I know what I know, and I know it well, not to ever forget. Until I realized I didn't know shit. The day I came home.
We've been waiting for you.
I met a little boy that resembled my features. Nappy afro, gap in his smile. Hand-me-down sneakers bounce through the crowd. Running number home men and women that crossed him. Sunbeaming on his BDBs, exhausted. Tossing footballs with his ashy black ankles. Breaking new laws, mama passed on home training. He looked at me and said, Kendrick, you do know my language. You just forgot because of what public schools had painted. You pick destiny, hope for rest in peace, then be an advocate. Tell your homies especially to come back home.
Wow.
I
like when he goes,
ah. I thought I found you back in the ghetto when I was 17 with the 30th best show. Maybe you in a dollar bill, maybe you're not real. Maybe only the wrong thing, get to know how you feel. Maybe you're paranoid, ha. Maybe I don't need you anyway. Don't lie to me, I'm suicidal anyway. I can be your heaven again, I can preach for you if you tell me what the matter is.
All right, that is Mama. What did you think about that one, Dad?
I like the way he went through all the things he thought he knew.
Mm-hmm.
And then when he got back home, he found out that all the things he thought he knew, he didn't know anything.
Mm-hmm.
And then he's just, the dude is nice, man. He's nice. Good song.
Awesome. Just a little bit of explanation to that song. So, you know, he's just had this kind of like dream sequence or conversation with Lucy.
Mm-hmm.
And then he decides to go back home. Some people might interpret it that he went home to Compton.
Mm-hmm.
But then he talks about how he met a boy. And then he's telling him that you do know my language, Kendrick. You just forgot it because of what public schools had taught you or something like mm-hmm. that. So a lot of people interpret it that he's talking about a boy that he met in South Africa mm-hmm. and saying that he does know the African language. You mm-hmm. just have forgotten it because, you know, whatever, you know, you're not connected to the motherland or whatever.
Right,
like that.
Right. Right. I can see that. I can see that too. His description of the young boy's ashy ankles and all that kind of stuff and the beady head and all that, you know. I just like the way the dude puts things together.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So that was a good song. I mean, yeah, you could reference to Compton or you could. I didn't know he took a trip to Africa, but I mean, after knowing that story, mm-hmm. yeah, you could apply what he said to that too. So
yeah.
That could have been applied to a little kid in Compton,
mm-hmm.
you know, because you had the little ashy leg, little brothers running around playing football, whatever they was doing,
yeah.
you know, just like kids do. You know, so yeah, that could be applied to all around the world.
Yeah, for
you know,
sure.
But yeah, I understood where he was coming from. So, good song, really good song, deep.
Cool.
Deep.
All right, so we'll go ahead and move into track number 10, which is Hood Politics. This one is produced by Tay Beast, Soundwave, and Thundercat.
This reminds me of I guess what you guys would be called blunt music.
You just get high, like
yeah. You just you gotta sit back like, and put it on and be like, and just listen to them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because it's so poetic, it's so thoughtful, thought-provoking.
For sure.
All of that, man. So you just sit back and...
Yeah, so to reference something that a lot of our Eminem fans had to say, because I said in our Eminem video that this isn't something that I ride around to.
Uh-huh.
So I will also say about To Pimp a Butterfly, mm-hmm. this isn't something I would ride around to. This isn't something I would just get in my car.
You, when you get in your car, you want, yeah, yeah. You know.
But they came at me because I said that. So you only listen to music you can da 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 da. But so this is something.
Well, that's the way you like to listen to your music.
Right. But this is something that I would absolutely, like you're saying, mm-hmm. sit at home, analyze, sit there and just vibe out to it, sit there and mm-hmm. really think about what he's saying, read mm-hmm. the lyrics, try to follow on along with the storyline. And like dissect it and really get into it and yeah. and break down what he's.
I know how about. I'm gonna listen to it next.
Yeah,
I'm gonna be like, you know, chilling, you know, just like dim them lights down low, mm-hmm. relax,
mm-hmm.
you know, and
just get into
just
it,
take it in,
yeah,
just
for
take
sure,
it all in,
absolutely. And it's what's so dope about it is, you know, he is hitting on all of these really deep, heavy topics mm-hmm. and stuff. But it's all over this landscape of just beautiful, jazzy, funky, yeah. cool.
That's why I said it's
instrumentation.
And then with the jazzy, because jazzy always, when I look at the style of jazz that he's putting into this album, jazzy always reminds me of these smoke-filled rooms mm-hmm. and, you know, some back alley that you go to the
yeah.
to the club and you walk in and the lights are low.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean?
You got a whiskey, yeah. a whiskey neat.
Yeah, you know? Exactly. You got it. For you sure. got it. So
a cigar.
Yeah, that's why I said at home, dim the lights, you know, make it like a nightclub atmosphere.
Yeah, for
you know
sure.
I mean?
So, chilling yeah. the man cave.
Yeah, there you go.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
All right, cool. So we'll go ahead and move on to the next track. This one is titled Hood Politics.
Hood Politics, oh boy.
On Hood Politics. So his wings are emerging, but he's still not the full caterpillar at this point in time. So he gets a voicemail, and then he gets kind of triggered from this voicemail.
So he's got still some struggles.
And yeah, he's still working
on
him.
He's a work in progress.
Yeah, for sure.
Still, okay.
So here's Hood Politics. All right.
Beat you before. Some weirdo rap shit, nigga.
That's nice.
No socks and skinny jeans and shit.
Skinny jeans and shit.
Hey, call me on
Shaniqua's phone. Alright. Call me on Shaniqua. Why I gotta be Shaniqua?
I've been A1 since day one, you niggas boo boo. Your homeboy, your black that you're from, boo boo. Little hoes you went to school with, boo boo. Baby mama and your new bitch, boo boo. We was in the hood, 14 with the deuce deuce. 14 years later, going hard like we used to on the dead homies. On the dead homies. Give a fuck about no politics and rap, my nigga.
Nigga.
A little homie stunner deuce ain't never coming back, my nigga.
Nigga.
So you better go hard every time you jump on wax, my nigga.
Nigga.
Fuck what they talk about, your shit is where it's at, my nigga.
Nigga.
Came in this game, you stuck your fangs in this game. You want no chain in this game, your hood, your name in this game. Now you double up, time to bubble up the bread and huddle up. Stick it to the scripts, now if them Benjamins go cuddle up. Skip, hop, drip, drop, flip, flop with the white tube sock. It goes. That's what the products smell like when the chemicals mix. 50 niggas salute out the Compton Zoo with the extras. I've been A1 since day one, you niggas boo boo. Your own boy, your block that you're from, boo boo. Little hoes you went to school with, boo boo. Baby mama and your new bitch, boo boo. We was in the hood, 14 with the deuce deuce. 14 years later, going hard like we used to on the dead homies. Call to get the coast involved, the history repeat. But I resolved inside that private hall while sitting down with Jay. He said it's funny how one verse can fuck up the game. I've been A1 since day one, you niggas boo boo. I remember you was conflicted, misusing your influence. I was entering a new one.
All right, so That was Hood Politics. What did you think about that one, Dad?
That was a good song. Boo boo. It was, I like that song. It had a lot. He had a lot of. He covered a lot of stuff. I guess he, you know, from what I picked up on it, it was some hood politics he talked about, and then he kind of moved from that politics to politics that's going around us, you know, that's happening today.
Mm-hmm.
He kind of blended that into it
from Compton to Congress.
Right. Yeah. Right. So it was.
The Democrats and Republicans.
It was a good song, man. I just like his message, man. He's just like he's telling it like it is.
Mm-hmm. So with Mama, you know, it's kind of showing his growth and where he was at currently.
When he's a kid.
Well, this one, Hood Politics, it kind of was him reverting back to his old mindset. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I mean, he's breaking down, you know, some political stuff in there as well as, you know, things that are going on in Compton and, you know, how the politics work in the hood. So,
mm-hmm. What was he talking about when he said he's the only one stand next to Snoop and push the button?
He's saying like his out of the West Coast, like he's one of the most influential artists. You know,
what's the push the button? What's that reference?
Like
to?
you can make just shit happen.
Whatever. Oh, okay.
Whatever
I
want to do, I can I can make it happen. I can push the button.
So he gave Snoop some prop, mm-hmm. pretty much too. So.
Oh yeah, for sure. He also talks about just like his him being the leader in the rap game. He also references a verse that he spit. There's this song called Control.
Mm-hmm.
It's a Big Sean song, and it featured Kendrick Lamar. And mm-hmm. on this song, Kendrick Lamar absolutely slaughtered everybody in the whole rap game. He called out every single big rapper and told them that he could kill them and they don't want no smoke and they should not even try to
just leave him alone.
Just don't even try it. And he called everybody out. J. Cole, Drake, Big Sean, Drake, J. Cole, Big Sean, Wale, all the biggest rappers.
He called Jay-Z out too.
I don't know if he said Jay, but
I bet he messed with Eminem though. He messed with him.
I would have to pull up the list, but he was basically saying everybody.
Because he can say everybody, but he better not mention the name Eminem. Because Eminem a smoking man. I'm telling you, Eminem,
that would be the only fair battle I feel like Eminem could be in.
Right.
I don't think anybody else would even give up a fair fight.
Right.
But Kendrick. I would love to see Kendrick.
Yeah, because I know Eminem would clap back hard, man.
That'd be nuts. But I think they respect each other way too much.
Yeah, they ain't
gonna go. I don't think they would ever. Go there. But anyway, he references that verse because it was like this really big moment in the hip hop game. Control came out and it was like, it was such a big deal. And he references it because he said how Jay-Z told him, it's funny how one verse could fuck up the whole game. And he's referencing like his Control verse and how nobody really wanted no smoke with that. So,
all right.
But that is that. At the end of the poem here, we have a couple new lines.
Yeah, he did. I noticed the poem is getting longer.
Mm-hmm.
Is he adding on as he goes?
So he covers like survivor's guilt, going back and forth, trying to convince myself the stripes I earned or maybe how A1 my foundation was. But while my loved ones was fighting a continuous war back in the city, I was entering a new one. So this is where... he definitely goes to South Africa in this song. This one is called How Much a Dollar Costs, featuring James Fauntleroy with some vocals, beautiful vocals from James. And it's produced by Love Dragon.
Love Dragon.
Yeah.
All right.
So.
Love Dragon. I can come up with a name.
So on this one, basically he's going to meet a man at a gas station and they're going to have a conversation. So yeah, he's in South Africa and he meets a man and they have a conversation. Mm. How much a dollar costs?
All right.
Thank you. much a dollar really costs. The question is detrimental, paralyzing my thoughts. Parasites in my stomach keep me with a gut feeling, y'all. Gotta see how I'm chilling once I park this luxury car. Hopping out, feeling big as Mutombo. 20 on pump 6, Dirty Marcellus called me Dumbo. 20 years ago, can't forget. Now I can lend him an ear or two. How to stack these residuals tenfold. The liberal concept that men do. 20 on 6, it didn't hit.
What a sun.
Staring at me, I grabbed my key. He's staring at me, I started the car, then I tried to leave. But something told me to keep it in park until I could see the reason why he was mad at a stranger. Like I was supposed to save him, like I'm the reason he homeless and that.
All in me.
Tripping and feeling resentment. I never met a transient that demanded attention. They got me frustrated, indecisive, and power tripping. Sour emotions got me looking at the universe different. I should distance myself, I should keep it relentless. My selfishness is what got me here, who the fuck I'm kidding? So I'ma tell you like I told the last bum. Crumbs and pennies, I need all of mine. And I recognize this type of panhandling all the time. I got better judgment.
Grace, what more do you want from me? Tears of a clown. Guess I'm not all what it's meant to be. Shades of gray will never change if I condone. Turn this page, help me change to right my wrong.
All right, how much a dollar costs? What'd you think about that one, Dad?
That was a good song, man. So the guy at the gas station, he's down on his luck. He's a crackhead. He's trying to make Kendrick feel like he's put him in a guilt trip because he won't give him any money for crack. And then the dude starts staring him down. Then Kendrick gets a little upset about that, and he starts staring, giving the stare down back.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then a whole bunch of emotions started going through Kendrick, you know, about how he got his money, I guess. And, mm-hmm. You know, yeah, it was a good story.
Yeah.
It was good. It was good. And deep, man, deep. And I don't know where he... And then they lost me at the end, kind of at the end when he was talking about I am the Messiah and stuff like that. And he did reference some scripture in Exodus, I believe it was.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, then he kind of... dig into that.
He actually revealed... So the homeless man... Everything you said is true, and then at the third verse, the homeless man reveals to him, to Kendrick, that he is God.
Mm-hmm.
And he was trying to basically tell him that the cost of the dollar was your acceptance into, like, heaven.
Oh, okay, yeah. Okay. Yeah, but I mean, you know, what threw me off, because the dude, he seen it, you know, he was a crackhead. And then the crackhead
was Kendrick's assumption.
Oh, okay.
He assumed that he was a crackhead.
See, because I thought somewhere in there that he said he saw the crack.
Maybe, but I guess the point that he was trying to make was just the fact that he referenced Exodus 14 and saying that, you know, a humble man is all we ever need. So you got Kendrick Lamar, this larger than life persona pulls up to a gas station, a fancy car, and he's been tainted and jaded by, you know, where he comes from, and he sees crackheads all the time, and I know somebody hustling when I see it. And you're just gonna go drink this up, you're just gonna smoke this rock, and the guy is just asking for one singular dollar. And I guess this is just kind of like the moment in the story where Kendrick has his, like, full awakening. And this is where he, like, meets God. It's like a metaphor for, you know, meeting God and humbling himself.
Right.
Finally.
Okay.
Yeah.
Nice.
Nice.
Kendrick had some real struggles with his morality, and yeah, he's.
So I think that's one of the main themes here, is, you know, knowing the right thing, but then having access to being able to be so not moral, you know.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's when he got to success, I imagine that he got to such a huge success that all the wealth and the things that came along with it kind of blinded him to real life and mm-hmm. real situations and real people. And, you know, that kind of focused him and brought him back,
mm-hmm.
You know, so.
Yeah, I think that's pretty much, you know, the point of everything is, right? Like, it's all the two sides of the corner. Like, yeah, you're successful and you're out the hood, but now you're disconnected. Mm-hmm. You weren't there for your friends when they got shot.
Right.
You know, you weren't able to influence your little sister to not go out and have a teenage pregnancy.
Yeah.
You know, and he's fighting with that, but also...
He need to cut himself a break, though, man. I mean, he couldn't achieve the success that he reached if he didn't put in the work.
Mm-hmm.
And if he had to worry about everybody else's problem first, then he would just be down there with them too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so to me, it was better for him to achieve his success.
So he can help more people.
Exactly.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that's where he's coming to. He's realizing, you know, like he was hard on himself earlier, and he's realizing, like, he has to focus on what he can control.
Right.
You know, and do the best that he can, and, you know, cut off like the distractions and the immoral things and the women and the
right
embellishing and bragging and all that stuff, mm-hmm. and focus on what's like actually important.
Right.
Yeah, such a journey, this album.
It is. it really is.
So then we'll go ahead and roll into the next song, which is Complexion. So I think we're in the fourth act here. So mamahood politics and how much a dollar costs. So, you know, he didn't want himself to self-destruct, the evils of Lucy all around him. He finally came home. But that didn't stop the survivor's guilt, going back mm-hmm. and forth, trying to convince myself the stripes I earned or maybe how A1 my foundation was.
Mm-hmm.
But while my loved ones was fighting the continuous war back in the city, I was entering a new one. That's when he gets to South Africa. He meets this guy at the gas station, reveals himself to be God. So, yeah, like, also that's another, like, duality that he's, like, talked about. Like, Lucy and Uncle Sam were, like, an incarnation of the devil.
right.
And now he's, like...
Now he's introduced to God.
Right.
Okay.
So it's just... Oh, man, it's just so much stuff. Okay. So the next song is called Complexion, A Zulu Love. So finally free, the butterfly sheds light on situations that the caterpillar never considered, ending the internal struggle.
Wow.
Although the butterfly and caterpillar are completely different, they are one and the same.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the butterfly sheds light.
I'm with this.
Complexion.
Two steps.
Complexion don't mean a thing.
It's a solo line.
Ooh, complexion.
Two steps.
It all feels the same.
It's a Zulu vibe.
Dark is the midnight hour, her bright is the morning sun. Give a fuck about your complexion, I know what the German's done. Sneak. Dark is the midnight hour, her bright is the morning sun. Brown skinned, but your blue eyes tell me your mama can't run. Sneak me through the back window, I'm a good field nigga. I made a flower for you out of cotton just to chill with you. You know I go the distance, you know I'm 10 toes down even if messing listening. I got the world attention, so I'ma say something that's vital and critical for survival of mankind. The feline color should never rival. Beauty is what you make it, I used to be so mistaken by different shades and faces. Then wit told me a woman is woman, love the creation. It all came from God, then you was my confirmation. I came to where you reside.
I love it. Where the homegirl Rhapsody at? I need you to speak your mind real quick, loved one.
Let me talk, my Stu Scott. Excuse me on my Tupac. Keep your head up, when did you stop? Love and die. Color your skin, color your eyes. That's the real blues, baby, like you met Jay's, baby. You blew me away. You think more beauty in blue, green, and gray. On my Solomon up north, 12 years a slave, 12 years of age, thinking my shade too dark. I love myself, I no longer need you, Q-Puck.
Barefoot babies with no care.
Teenage Gun told us that don't play fair. Should I get out the car? I don't see Compton. I see something much worse. The land of the landmines, the hell that's on earth.
All right, wow. That is Complexion. What'd you think about that one, Dad?
That was another deep song. Talking about complexion, I guess, you know, all shades. We all come in different shades, and we all still the same, you know, as a whole, as a people. And that was a good song, man. And then he finally did something like, he has been referencing some gang stuff. He talked about the boys, the 15-year-olds running around. They ain't got no shame in their game. They ruthless.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, they don't. There's no honor in what they do in the streets, mm-hmm. and stuff like that. And basically, he's saying, you know, Compton is like hell on earth.
Mm.
You know, so those are some of the things I picked up in this song.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, he's definitely, you know, talking about how, you know, you're beautiful no matter what your complexion is. And
mm-hmm.
There's like this whole colorism conversation in the black community mm-hmm. that he's addressing. And it goes back to slavery when like there was house slaves and outside slaves, right?
The field slaves were sneaking in, getting with the house slaves. Mm-hmm. He's bringing them little cotton flowers and stuff. Mm-hmm. That was good. That was good.
Yeah.
Real. It was real.
Dope. All right. We'll go ahead and move on to the next track, which is titled The Black or the Berry.
The sweeter the juice.
Mm-hmm. This one is produced by Ken Lewis, Zale, Boy Wanda, Kaz, and Terrace Martin. Oh, yeah. I did want to ask you, what did you think about Rapsody's verse, that the female rapper on this last song?
Yeah, I was going to ask you about her, too. I'm glad you brought that back up because I've never heard her before. I don't believe. She sounded familiar. Her voice did sound familiar to me. It was a familiar voice. So it sounded like somebody, like, I guess, it reminded me kind of like a Salt and Pepper kind of.
Oh, okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
for
sure.
She had that kind of voice when she rapped, and she's smooth.
Yeah.
She's smooth.
She's actually the only featured rapper on this album. Kendrick does all the rapping. There's a few R&B singers and stuff, but yeah, she's the only rapper with a guest verse on this album.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she's really dope. She's super lyrical. She had a bunch of, her verse is full of like really cool lines if you like breaking down and really get into it. But yeah, she's dope.
Yeah, I agree.
She has a really good. She's fairly new in the rap game.
Has she ever featured her own album yet?
She has an album, and it was very critically acclaimed. People, you know, really, really enjoyed it.
Hmm.
I never listened to it.
Okay.
But I know it got received very well.
Cool.
Not on a major level, but like in the underground community, it's she's very respected.
Okay.
She's on Kendrick's To Pimp a Butterfly. So that right there, she could have did that and just stopped. And
right,
she
exactly.
She would be a legend. So,
right.
All right, this next track is The Black or the Berry. I'm just going to play it.
All right.
Shame, they may call me crazy. They may say I suffer from schizophrenia or something, but won't you? You're fucking evil. I want you to recognize that I'm a proud monkey. You vandalized my perception, but can't take down from it. And this is more than confession. I mean, I might press the button just so you know my discretion. I'm guarding my feelings. I know that you feel it. You sabotage my community, making a killing. You made me a killer. Emancipation of a real nigga.
The black of the berry, the sweet of the juice. The black of the berry, the sweet of the juice.
The blacker the berry, the sweeter the juice. The blacker the berry, the bigger I shoot.
I said them shit like a slave, can be black. Hold the feel my leap of pain, can be black. I'm an asset of put me in a chain, can be black.
I take the pill out, muscle cars like pull-ups. Show you what these big wheels about. Black is successful, this black man meant to be special. Cat scans on my radar, bitch, how can I help you? How can I tell you I'm making a killing? You made me a killer, emancipation of a real nigga.
The black of the berry, the sweeter the juice. The black of the berry, the sweeter the juice. The black of the berry, the sweeter the juice. The black of the berry, the bigger I shoot.
I said them shit like a slave, can be black. Hold the field, my leap of pain, can be black. I'm an asset, they put me in a chain, can be black.
As blunt as it gets, I know you hate me, don't you? You hate my people, I can tell cause there's threats when I see you. I can tell cause your waist is evil. No, I can tell because you in love with the desert eagle. Thinking maliciously, he get a chain, then you gon' bleed him. It's funny how Zulu and Thosa might go to war. Two tribal armies that wanna build and destroy. Remind me of these Compton Crip gangs that live next door. Beefing with power rules, only death settled the score. So no matter how much I say I like to preach with the Panthers, or tell Georgia State Marcus Garvey got all the answers, or try to celebrate February like it's my B-Day, or eat watermelon chicken and Kool-Aid on weekdays, or jump high enough to get Michael Jordan endorsements, or watch BET cause urban support is important. So why did I weep when Trayvon Martin was in the street, when gangbanging make me kill a nigga blacker than me?
Point taken. That's real talk.
Woo. All right, that is The Black of the Berry by Kendrick Lamar. What'd you think about that one, Dad?
That's probably one of my favorites on this song. I mean, on this album. That's probably one of my favorites.
Except the one that was had that like, he's only had one song here. He's got that bounce to it, kind of, you know, beat to it.
Was that King Kunta or All Right?
I think it was All Right. I'm not sure. I think it was All Right.
Okay, but
it had a real nice upbeat to it, you know, like something you would bounce to in your car.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the only song that I've heard with that kind of style on this album so far is that one song. Now, that one was probably my favorite.
Mm-hmm.
But then the Black of the Berry, that hit home because that speaks to a lot of things that I've been saying recently about different things going on in the world today. And that kind of touched me personally,
mm-hmm.
you know, so I liked it. I really liked that song. So I'll make that my second favorite on this particular album, although everything I've heard on this album is just like poetic, prophetic. You know, it's a really good album, man. It's rich, man.
It's very, very rich, very dense in like the details. I mean, the details are just everywhere. I mean, it's just so deep. Every single line.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's no wasted lyric.
No.
There's no filler.
Nope.
Yeah, Black of the Berry.
Mm-hmm.
So what did you think about, I guess, like his message in here? Did you kind of peep what the hypocrite line? You know, he starts.
Which one?
Well, the first two verses start with, "I'm the biggest hypocrite of 2015. And then he goes into the verse, but he doesn't really explain why he's a hypocrite until the third verse.
Okay.
And then on the third verse, he tells all the reasons why, or he sums it up, the very last line, as to why he's a hypocrite. When gangbanging made me kill a nigga blacker than me.
Right, right, exactly. And that's what I, you know, that's one of the things that I've been talking about. I mean, that's some things that I've been addressing with all the social injustice, so to speak, that's happening in the country. You know, they talk about, police brutality and police this and that. Well, we kill each other more than any police have killed us, you know what I mean? The body bags are piling up right now as we speak, and it's us killing us. And that's what he said. He said he'd kill a nigga darker than him. Why should he cry over Trayvon? That's one deal, but we got, you know, Bloods and Crips piling up bodies, you know, brothers in Chicago piling up bodies every weekend, and that's the elephant in the room that nobody wants to talk about. Mm-hmm. They just don't want to talk about it. So, I mean, he is. He's like, shoot, I'm the biggest hypocrite in 2015. You know, he's telling the truth. He's just telling everybody, man, people don't want to hear it, but he told them. Yeah. You know?
Dope.
Yeah, yeah.
Black of the berry.
Black of the berry, the sweet of the juice. We say that all the time, but we referred that to something else.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think that Kendrick is aware of that too. And
yeah, I know the way sure that he's
using it in like
in his way,
changing the you know meaning mm-hmm. there.
He's very clever, man. Very smart.
Just because you wore a different gang color than mine doesn't mean I can't respect you as a black man. That's one of the notes here.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, during this. Act of the album, The Butterfly Shedding Light. He's just really reflecting on his thoughts in this portion of the album, and mm-hmm. he's coming up with these new ideas that, as the butterfly, that he never even thought of as a caterpillar.
Caterpillar, yes.
So just the self-empowerment, the reflection, the reconciliation, the self-respect, and that's just continuing with that theme. We will go ahead and roll into the next track, which is titled You Ain't Gotta Lie, Mama Said.
Uh-oh. You ain't gotta lie, Mama said. Mama said it.
Yeah, so You Ain't Gotta Lie, Mama Said, and this one is track number 14. All right, track number 14, Mama. You Ain't Gotta Lie, Mama Said, and this one is produced... Oh my God, by Love Dragon.
Uh-oh.
Love Dragon. Oh, and so Love Dragon is just like the code name for Terrace Martin and one of the other producers.
Mm-hmm.
So they call themselves Love Dragon. So that's pretty much Terrace Martin, pretty much the same people that have been producing the rest of the album.
Okay.
I think this one's pretty straightforward. I'll let you pick this up. Here we go. You Ain't Gotta Lie.
Steady long, steady wrong, nigga. Hey, y'all close that front door. Y'all let flies in this motherfucker.
Yeah.
Spot you a mile away, I can see your insecurities written all on your face. So predictable your words, I know what you're gonna say. Who you fooling or you assuming you can just come and hang with the homies, but your love for realness ain't the same. Circus acts only attract those that entertain. Small talk, we know that it's all talk. We live in the laugh factory every time they mention your name. You ain't gotta lie to kick in my neck. You ain't gotta lie, you ain't gotta lie. You ain't gotta lie to kick in my neck. You ain't gotta try so hard.
That's right.
We ain't gotta lie. We ain't gotta lie. We ain't gotta lie to kick him.
Complex.
Emotional.
Complex.
Self-pick.
Complex.
Under oath.
Complex. The loudest one in the room, nigga. That's a complex. Let me put it back in proper context.
Right.
You ain't gotta lie to kick him, my nigga. We ain't gotta lie. We ain't gotta lie. We ain't gotta lie to kick him, my nigga. Got the burning stash to impress me. It's all in your head, homie. Ask her where the plug at to impress me. Ask her where the jug at to impress me. Ask her where it's at, only upsets me. You sound like the feds on me. What do you got to offer? Tell me before we offer you. Put you deep in that coffin. Been allergic to talking. Been aversion to bullshit. Sell a dream in the auction. Tell me just what your boss is. Niggas be fugazi. Bitches be fugazi. This is for fugazi. Niggas and bitches who make habitual line babies. Bless them little hearts. You can never persuade me. You can never relate me. To him, to her, or that, to them, or you. The truth, you love to bend.
All right, that is You Ain't Gotta Lie to Kick It.
You don't.
What do you think about that one, Dad?
You don't gotta lie to kick it. That's one of my favorite phrases. You got to lie to kick it, you know. Just be yourself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this is just continuing on with the theme and narrative. Basically, he's saying that his mom, basically he's rapping from the perspective of his mom.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like... basically telling somebody that they ain't got a lot of kick it.
That's right. That's right.
And just continue with the theme of his growth and being authentic, his authentic self, and encouraging others to do the same thing.
Keep it real.
For sure.
100.
So then we will go ahead and roll right into track 15, which is titled I. What's that?
Chris the Snake.
Oh.
Send me a picture of it. He got a little pet. I was glad he didn't get a dog yet. He's not ready for
it. No, not at all. All right. We'll go ahead and roll right into track number 15, titled I.
That's the album version too.
Yes, this is the album version. So the
You got Ronald Isley on this one too?
Yep.
Okay.
So yeah, this is the album version. It's like a live version, but it's not actually live. It's like a recorded version of a live version.
Okay.
There was a studio version that was released as a single before this album came out, but in the context of the album, I think he's like back home. Because he just, let me tell you what my mama has said. It sounds like they're kind of like at a barbecue or something. And then he's performing here on this track, like presumably in Compton.
Mm-hmm.
So in the narrative of the story, he's back at home and he's performing in Compton and he's doing this song.
Okay.
So here is I.
I done been through a whole lot. Tried tribulation, but I know God. The devil wanna put me in a bow tie. Pray that the holy water don't go dry. Yeah, yeah. As I look around me, so many motherfuckers wanna down me. But enemy gon' never drown me. In front of a dirty devil, man, when they found me. And I love myself. Huh, when you're looking at me, tell me what you see.
Yeah.
I put a bullet in the back of the back of the head.
I love myself.
Illuminated by the hand of God. Boy, don't seem shy.
I love myself.
One day at a time. They wanna say it's a war outside. Bomb in the street, gun in the hood. Mob or police, these cold faces. Post up, feet, fight, hope for a basis. Dreams are reality's peace. Blow steam in the face of the beast. Sky can fall down, wind can cry now. Look at me, motherfucker, I smile.
I love myself.
And when you're looking at me, tell me what do you see?
I love myself.
I put a bullet in the back of the back of the head and a police.
I love myself.
Illuminated. All y'all come to the front, y'all come up to the front. Baby, get back in the head and a police. Illuminated by the hand of God, boy, don't seem shy.
I love myself.
I went to war last night. With an automatic weapon, don't nobody call a medic. I'ma do it till I get it right. Then Bobby Reed from a negative and letting them annihilate me. And it's running in a moon at a meaningless speed. Finna run into a gun and let my body.
Not on my time.
This gave me some game in real person. Retrace my steps on what they never taught me. Did my homework fast before government caught me. So I'ma dedicate this one verse to Oprah on how the infamous, sensitive N-word control us. So many artists gave her an explanation to hold us. Well, this is my explanation, straight from Ethiopia. N-E-G-U-S. Definition, royalty. King royalty. Wait, listen. N-E-G-U-S. Description, black emperor, king ruler. Now let me finish the history book. So,
all right, that is I, the album version. What do you think about that one, Dad?
Word. That song was knowledge. He's dropping knowledge. The boy is bad. The boy is bad. I'm telling you, man. That was a good song. And I like that they sampled Who's That Lady from the Isleys.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that was tight. And then they even, boy, that bass was killer.
Mm-hmm.
And that bass line, boom. Yeah, it was a good song all the way around, and my boy was just dropping some truth bombs everywhere, man.
Mm-hmm.
So, good song again.
Dope. So I is kind of continuing the part where he's like, and he's become his enlightened self, mm-hmm. and he's bringing the message back to Compton, and he's using his music for a positive thing, like even like breaking up the fight in the mm-hmm. crowd, you know, and then he goes into like the little. Acapella
right.
rap and breaking down some knowledge and stuff. And it's also notable that this one is titled I, just the letter I. Mm. And there was a track earlier in the album that was U, with the letter U.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the one where he was really beating himself up in the mirror.
Right.
And just the contrast of you
and I,
is now he's, I love myself.
Right.
And that song was, Loving Me Was Complicated, Loving Me and Complicated. And now he's.
So the other interesting thing was he mentioned that he's been struggling with depression since he was a kid. And I'm pretty sure he's still, he's not saying that he's over with it. He's still struggling with depression. And I think that this is where some of the deep thoughts that he lays down on his tracks come from, man. It's coming from that when he's going through a depressed mood or stage.
Mm-hmm.
I think that sometimes that's when people do their deepest thinking.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it's dark. Sometimes, I mean, you know, it's just, I can tell, man, it, what he talks, the way he talks and the way he explains things,
mm-hmm.
it is coming from a sometimes a dark place, man, because... And it seems like he is. He does suffer with depression.
Yeah.
So, but man, you think of a person that has all that fame and wealth and everything at the world at his fingertips, why would a person be depressed? But it just goes to show you, money can't buy you everything, man. You know.
Yeah.
So anyway, it's a good song.
And it honestly seems like the way that he describes it, it seems as if the money has brought him new and greater obstacles
mm-hmm.
to overcome, at least internally.
Mm-hmm.
That
could add to his depression as well.
Right,
You know, you had a different kind of pressure, mm-hmm. you know, when you get money and fame and everything, so.
For sure.
Yeah.
Cool. So that is I, and we'll roll into the last track here entitled Mortal Man.
Mortal Man.
This is produced by Soundwave. And all right. We'll go ahead and get into track number 16, Mortal Man, produced by Soundwave, track 16 on To Pimp a Butterfly. Here we go.
All right.
Hold on. I guess it's worth it to mention from the breakdown that dissected, they believe that I, the last song here that mm-hmm. we just listened to,
yeah.
they're saying that would be the completion of the actual storyline. Mortal Man serves as more of an epilogue
mm-hmm.
or like a afterthought of the album.
Right.
It is the last track here, but I just wanted to kind of put that in perspective.
Okay.
We started at Wesley's Theory and we've gone all the way through and we got into I, and that's the final incarnation of the butterfly. Mm-hmm. He loves himself. He's got mm-hmm. self-love. He's spreading that love. He's spreading his message.
He's free.
He's using his influence and power mm-hmm. to spread positivity and uplift his community and all of those things.
Okay.
So we'll get into Mortal Man.
All right.
Mandela, hope my flow stay propelling. Let these words be your earth and moon. You consume every message. As I lead this army, make room for mistakes and depression. And with that being said, my nigga, let me ask this question. When shit hit the fan, is you still a fan? When shit hit the fan. When shit hit the fan, is you still a fan? Do you believe in me? Are you deceiving me? Could I let you down easily? Is your heart where it need to be? Is your smile on permanent? Is your foul on lifetime? What you know where the sermon is? If I died in this next line? If I'm tried in the court of law? If the industry cut me off? If the government want me dead? Pack cocaine in my car? Would you judge me a drug head? Or see me as Kay Lamar? Or question my character and degrade me on every block? Want you to love me like Nelson? Want you to hug me like Nelson? Time? Like who got your best interest? Like how much
much are you dependent? How clutch are the people that say they love you and who pretended? How tough is your skin when they turn you in? Do you show forgiveness? What brush do you bend with dust in your shoulders from being offended? What kind of den did they put you in when the lions start hissing? What kind of bridge did they burn revenge on your mind when it's mentioned? You wanna love like Nelson, you wanna be like Nelson, you wanna walk in his shoes, but your peacemaking seldom. You wanna be remembered and deliver the message that considered the blessing of everyone. This your lesson for everyone. Say when shit hit the fan, issues still a fan to me. Issues I hold grudges like bad judges. Don't let me resent you. That's not Nelson like. Want you to love me like Nelson. I went to Robin's Island, analyzing. That's where his cell is, so I can find clarity. Like how much you cherish me. Is this relationship a fake or real as the heavens be? See, I gotta question it all. Family, friends, fans, cats, dogs, trees, plants, grass. How the wind blow? Murphy's Law, Generation X. Will I ever be your ex? Flaws of a baby step, marred by the mouth a bit. Pause, put me under stress. Crawled under rocks, ducking y'all. It's respect, but then tomorrow, put my back against the wall. How many leaders you said you needed, then left them for dead? Is it Moses? Is it Huey Newton or Detroit Red? Is it Martin Luther, JFK shooter, you assassin? Is it Jackie? Is it Jesse? Oh, I know it's Michael Jackson. Oh, when shit hit the fan, is you still a fan?
But they might eat the rich.
They smoking right, so some good shit now.
Do you see yourself as somebody that's rich or somebody that made the best of their own opportunities?
I see myself as a natural born hustler, a true hustler in every sense of the word. Why you still want to shoot back? Because once you turn 30, it's like they take the heart and soul out of a man, out of a black man in this country, and you don't want to fight no more. And if you don't believe me, you can look around. You don't see no loudmouth 30-year-old motherfuckers.
Yes, you do.
That's crazy, because me being one of your offsprings of the legacy you left behind, I can truly tell you that it's nothing but turmoil going on. So I wanted to ask you, what you think is the future for me and my generation today?
I think that niggas is tired of grabbing shit out the stores, and next time it's a riot, it's gonna be like
Pop.
All right, that concludes Mortal Man, the last track here on To Pimp a Butterfly. What'd you think about that one, Dad?
Very, very interesting album. Very interesting. I like the way they summed it up. Told you a story, and it ended, you know, very well as far as I'm concerned. Some of their philosophies different, with some thinking, but then I was thinking that might be some of the kush they were smoking too. But that's okay. That's okay. All around thoughts about this album. It was genius, man. And the music in it was phenomenal. He sounds like, when his album reminds me of a Quincy Jones production. Mm. The way the he uses orchestras, he uses horns and pianos and violins, and it sounds like Quincy Jones is doing the production. It's really rich. It's nice.
What'd you think about so the whole poem thing, right? So the poem that he's reciting throughout the whole album culminates in the fact that he's actually reciting this poem to Tupac.
Yeah, yeah,
for that's an interview.
And that was what tripping me out too. I was like, damn, it's Pac. You know,
yeah.
So I like the way he put it together, because he gave you a little piece of the poem. Mm-hmm. Little by little, gradually, as you went through, you know, we listened to the album, and then at the end, you had the whole poem.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just well put together.
It's almost as if, like, you're watching a movie, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the poem is like this, the narrator,
mm-hmm.
right? And he's narrating the story with the poem. And then after the movie is over, then it cuts to a scene where it's like Tupac and Kendrick sitting in a room. And that was the basis of the movie,
yeah,
just their
so
conversation.
Cool.
It's like
so cool.
Visualizing that is just...
Yeah.
And you don't know that until you get to the end. The very end of the album.
Yep.
And it's just like...
That was so... Yeah, it was... The way they put it together, man, like I said, man, this guy, he's got his shit together, for real.
Yeah. And I think you kind of talk about, like, rap, right? In the rap game... Kendrick, he had a really successful album with the last album that we listened to, Good Kid, Mad City.
Mm-hmm.
It would have made all the sense in the world for him to just come out and put out another album and put a bunch of hits on there and hook up with this producer and that producer and stuff. But instead of doing that,
he pretty much kept everything in house on this one. I mean, it was all him.
Exactly. I mean, and instead of like trying to do something to reach commercial success, mm-hmm. instead he made this intricate, ingenious plot and carried it out through every single song, every single lyric, every single, like every track has to be in order for this to make sense. See, you know.
And you know what? Excuse me. You hear artists always talk about they want to do them. They want to do their music. They want to, you know, express themselves. And a lot of these labels, they don't allow them to do that because they want them to push out their commercial stuff. And
they're pimping them.
They pimping them.
Yep.
And so he's like pretty much, he took control of everything.
Yeah.
Everything. He don't care whether it's a hit or not. Mm-hmm. He's going to put his ideals out there. He's going to put his talent into this. In this project, and man, he just put his heart and soul into this album.
Absolutely.
He really did, man. That's all. This album told a lot about Kendrick Lamar as a person.
For sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. I really just don't think there's any album that I can think of that is this just deep and
it's deep, man. It's
connected,
intimate.
And
intimate. It's mind-blowing, dude. I'm telling you, you have to listen to this thing probably like, man, if you listen to it 20 times,
yeah,
you're going to hear, you're going to learn, you're going to pick up a little something each time different.
Mm-hmm.
Man, there's so much freaking knowledge packed into this one album.
For sure.
Yeah, so I liked it, man. It was a really good eye-opener. And okay, so rap ain't all fuck you, yeah, bitch, you know. So I get it.
Yeah.
But you know, some good guys out here, man. And I think when I was coming up listening to rap, man, it was so many guys trying to break into it that you had your trash rap and then you had your real cream of the crop guys that were rising up. And then the ones that were good rose to the top.
Mm-hmm.
And now you don't hear a lot of, you know, trashy rap.
Oh, there's still plenty of trash.
Well,
for sure.
I don't know if it's getting the attention that these guys get because they draw all of the attention. Yeah. I mean, damn. I mean, if he gives a concert, how many people you think going to be there?
He sells out football stadiums.
Okay, the trashy rap people, how many people you think?
They pack out places too. But not no football stadiums. There's in today's rap world, it's like attention versus talent. So there's rappers that command a lot of attention,
mm-hmm.
Which, you know, they don't have the talent, but they can get attention and get people to look at them.
Yep.
And then there's the guys that actually have the talent. And this is absolutely one of the most talented people to ever touch a mic.
Yeah.
This album is just crazy.
How old is this guy now? He's probably in his 40s now, isn't he?
Kendrick would probably... No. He's like in his early 30s.
He's still in his early 30s?
Mm-hmm.
Damn, when did he start?
This because To Pimp a Butterfly came out in 2015, and Kendrick is...
That's interesting art there, too, man, by the way.
Oh, yeah. He's 34 years old.
Wow.
Yeah, let me get your comment on what do you think about this artwork here? To Pimp a Butterfly artwork. So it looks like Kendrick and his homies from Compton are posted up in front of the White House and have got money and liquor and chains. And
see, the picture requires a whole lot of interpretation, just like his music. Yeah, you know what I mean?
For sure.
I mean, you got to just stare at it and you'll see all kind of messages from, you know, you can derive a whole lot of messages just coming from just looking at this. Like you said, the pictures, they got bottles. The dude's got bottles. He's, you know, he's probably drinking and pouring some out for the homies. You got people hold money. The White House in the back where he talked about politics.
Mm-hmm.
You know, all of that, man. There's so much stuff in that.
You seen this guy? What? The guy at the bottom? The white dude?
Oh, snap. They just stepped all over him, didn't they?
Yeah, it looks like they're kind of, I don't know if he's dead or passed out or beat up or something. I believe he's a judge.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, interesting artwork.
Yeah,
there's a million interpretations of that all over the internet.
People I bet.
Have all kind of different, you know. And the dope thing too is Kendrick leaves. He does answer a lot of these questions in his interviews about his music. Yeah, you can watch interviews where he'll kind of like explain a lot of the stuff. But a lot of the stuff too, he'll leave it, and he says well, that's up to interpretation.
Interpretation. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So yeah, Kendrick. Super complex artist. We're going to spend the next couple weeks listening to Kendrick music. We're going to listen to his next album, Damn, next week.
The new one that's coming out?
Nope. The new one that's coming out is Mr. Morale and the Big Steppers.
That's right.
So we're going to listen to that together for the first time. But next week, we're going to listen to Damn, which is his latest album. And it's nowhere near as like dense and... like heavy as this album.
It's lighting up.
Much lighter. This is a heavy album. It's like heavy topics. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, the other album is much lighter. Still very deep and still very thoughtful and, you know, it's a great story.
I can't imagine it not being good.
But yeah, it's just not as... This is
not like, as heavy.
Yeah, this is definitely a heavy, heavy album. It's a long album.
Thought-provoking.
For sure. But, yeah, that is To Pimp a Butterfly. If you enjoy our reactions, please make sure you give this video a big thumbs up. Also, drop a comment. Let us know what your favorite song off of To Pimp a Butterfly is, and also what we should listen to next. And make sure you turn on your post notifications. Make sure that you are notified every single time we drop another banger. If you don't like the cuts in our videos, and instead of leaving me a bunch of comments saying, why are you skipping the songs? If you feel that way, you could join our Patreon. And on our Patreon, all of our patrons get access to our full uncut reactions with no skips in the songs. So
there you go.
That's a solution for you. Or if you want to drop a comment that says, why are you skipping the songs? That's fine, too. We love all the comments, good and bad.
I really do.
We really appreciate all of the support. And, yeah, that's all I got. Till next time. Bye, guys.
Bye.